Well, welcome back, and today we're going to talk about screws. No, wait. Try that again. Today we're going to talk about the CypherCon 2.0 badge and just basically the conference in general. To start out with, I'm probably going to go over some of the history of the development process and then go into some of the specifics on the badge. And then ended up with just, you know, impressions of the conference and random things. So, to start out with, the way I became involved in this was the toy makers asked me to help out. First of all, look down in the description of this video, and there's a link to the toy makers video on the badge. Go watch that first. That goes over a lot of the details on what the badge can do. You know, it sort of gives you a good overview of what's going on with this thing. I'm not going to repeat that. I'm just going into, you know, sort of my view of the badge and the process of getting here. So, let me pull out my box of history and go get some more history. Okay, so this whole thing started out almost a year ago. It was basically 1 week after CypherCon 1. Addy and Whisker were giving the topic of fringe science, and we all headed, you know, they invited me out for sushi, so we went out to a sushi joint local here in town, and we're sitting talking about fringe science, and a bunch of different themes for the badge, you know, just sort of, not so much what it does, but sort of, you know, we want it to sort of look like this, and maybe do that, you know, just sort of rough ideas. And, you know, going on the fringe slash pseudoscience, we got into crystals. We're like, oh, it'd be cool if it was like a crystal wrapped in something that glowed, and we're thinking about the physics of how to do that, and eventually one of us, not exactly sure who mentioned it first, went, a cube. How about we do a cube instead? So that resulted in this guy. All the artwork and the internal puzzle or the text adventure, that sort of stuff, that's all the toy makers. I am not an artistic person to where I could come up with something like this. I'm good at the, I did the hardware portion of the bottom badge, and I'll get to that in a minute. But along those conversations, you know, I gave little hints like, you know, make sure to cut back this edge so that when you put these two back, the radius of that corner from the cutter going through and out doesn't bind up the cube when you solder them together. So from those initial beginnings of let's do a cube, it sort of expanded from there when they started fleshing together what they wanted to do in the cube. Along the way they decided they wanted to have USB so they can get into the text adventure, and they also wanted to talk cube to cube. Initially, you know, radio was discussed and that sort of stuff, but that gets you into FCC regulations and power problems. A past project they had a battery life issue that they didn't realize until way too late, and they couldn't fix it. So there was concerns about battery life and a few other things. So eventually they settled on, you know, USB connectivity and IRDA for talking badge to badge. Individually, you can buy chips that do both of those things, but they sort of looked at the pricing and it was just out of their budget for what they had to do the conference. So they were thinking, well, can we get a different microcontroller to handle that and then use the prop for everything else? They are a very prop-centric shop, so, you know, they didn't want to dump that on the little bit of time they had. You know, a year sounds like a lot, but for something of this scale, that is not a lot of time, especially when you only have two people working on it. So they sort of sucked me in because I know quite a bit about the PIC architecture and been doing that for many, many years. And we decided, yeah, that's something we could do. So starting going down that route, the first thing we did, or I did, is I spun a little card. And of course, this is not going to focus. Like this, which just basically has the USB connection to the processor, a couple footprints of processor and regulator just to see how bad they were to be, would be to solder, the IRDA modules, and then the charger circuit just so we could do a proof of concept that that portion of the device would work before we moved on to, you know, the actual badge. So here's one of the actual prototype cards all built up. So we had, you know, QLC leadless chip carriers for both the regulator, something a little weird, but it's a leadless chip carrier regulator and the PIC microcontroller. As you can see, there was some bodge wires in the original design. This one being the only actual oops, and these being bad parts. So this oops over here, the LED on the charger could be set up either to light up while it's charging and then turn off, or light up when it's fully charged. And I oopsied when I entered the logics and set it up for it lights up when it's fully charged versus on when it's charging, which is what I actually wanted. Originally we went with this brand of IRDA modules, and I found out quickly they're very, very sensitive to electrical noise, like super sensitive to the point where they're unusable in our design. So after about a month of screwing with these and not getting anywhere, we had to switch over to this, which does basically the same thing minus an IR function that we may or may not have used because of time, but the pinout was different, so I had to bodge wire some stuff in there to get them on the card and do all of our testing. So about the time that this card was done, you know, I had really good feelings on, yes, I can get USB working. In fact, I had it working. And as well, I could get IRDA from card to card working. You know, just with a sample of the two cards I had built up playing back and forth between them. This also proved out this regulator circuit. So my goals for the regulator was a high efficiency switch mode regulator that had a very low off current, so we could pre-assemble the badges before the cons with their batteries, and then once we got there, we could just pull them out, turn them on, and hand them out. So from there, the next step up was this mess, and this is a propeller activity board, I do believe. Somewhere on here it says what it is. That says propeller demo. So maybe this is just the demo board. But this big mess of wires here, the important ones, is this guy right here. And if you noticed, I pulled the prop crystal off and just soldered it on here so it wouldn't get lost. Although I think I might have broke it, so that might be dead anyways. And then I pumped in the clock that I'm generating on the PIC chip, instead of having a dedicated crystal for the propeller. That actually worked out first try, which was a little surprising. Others out there have done it, but it's not super well documented, using, you know, a generated clock from one chip to feed the PLL in the propeller to get it up to its operating speed. The rest of this wiring knot here, we hooked the two chips communicate via I2C. So this was just the pull-up resistors and some wiring to get I2C between the two so we could test that portion of the code out before we spun the final cards. From there, that brings us to these cards. So these are my original prototype cards are in the correct form factor, but none of the artwork, because that was the toy makers department. And we can go over some of the bits and pieces here. So this section right here is the battery charger and monitoring control. So this is a little 500 milliamp charge controller for a LiPo bag battery. And the toy makers sourced these 1800 milliamp hour batteries from China for the badges. They're just standard, you know, SAC LiPo batteries. This section right here is all of the LiPo battery to 3.3 volt buck boost regulator circuitry. Here is all, you know, this chip, the crystal, and these few parts over here is all the PIC support and my status indicator. On either side, you have the IRDA modules and their related parts. And then basically this little couple of resistors here, this EEPROM and the prop, you know, I basically just picked that up from the toy makers using one of the parallax reference designs. So, unique things about this. The first one is the regulator I'm actually bootstrapping. So when you plug in the battery, there's a pull down on the enable for the regulator that shuts it down. So in that state, the regulator is drawing, between the regulator and the battery sense divider, it draws about 6 microamps. So an 1800 milliamp hour battery, you know, 1.8 amp hours. At 6 microamps, that thing's going to last a very, very, very long time before it goes dead. So to actually start up the card, the power on button actually pulls that enable line high. And then the first thing the microcontroller does when it starts up is it toggles one of its IOs high, which is then routed into the enable line through a resistor. The goal there was that the on button can override the micro's enable line to the regulator. So if for some odd reason this micro was driving it low, the on button would take precedence and pull it high and then start up. And then if the button's open and the micro's tri-stated, then the weak pull down on that line would keep this guy off. So I sort of covered all my bases, but normally, you know, weak pull down, hard pull up with the power button, and then a medium either pull up or pull down based on the IO of the pick. Using that, you know, we were able to get it down to 6 microamps, so that worked out well. Only downside is it only comes in this little, the particular regulator I picked only comes in one of these leadless chip packages, which if you don't get thing, you know, if you're not using a solder mask or you don't place them just quite right, you can get shorts and then you got to refill them and fix them. It wasn't the end of the world. I mean, we were able to do it, so, but it still wasn't nearly as easy as these guys were. You know, as long as you're close and you tap your toaster oven, they usually get, usually turn out pretty good. Let's see, where to go to next. We switched to a oscillator, mostly because the crystal packages we could find for a reasonable price were huge. This sized. Where, you know, as you can see, this fits in much less of a footprint. I tried to find crystals in this package, and all the ones I found were pretty expensive, so for the same cost, I could get an oscillator, so I just went with an oscillator, because then you don't have to worry about, you know, parasitic capacitance or resistance causing your crystal to stop oscillating, or oscillate at a different frequency. Also, there is an LED with a pull-up that comes off the pick. That's my status light. It tells me a bunch of different states based on how it's blinking. What else? The IRDA modules, the power down lines are tied together and back to the pick, so I can power them down on demand. And then there's two UARTs that support IRDA in this particular pick, one going to each one. Once we got lots of these badges working and testing together, which unfortunately was very late in the game, we found there's some sort of issue going on in the IRDA module in this pick. I'm leaning towards the hardware bug in the thing, but it could still be software because we just didn't have the time to exhaustively test everything out. But what we'd see is the UR error interrupt would fire. And supposedly there's only three things that can cause that to fire, a framing error, a buffer overflow, and something else. When it fires, none of those bits were set. So it's like, okay, none of those conditions caused it, why did you fire? And once that fires, the IRDA stops receiving packets. I could still transmit just fine, but anything coming in was just lost. It was never firing the flag to say, hey, I got a packet. But again, that could be something in my code that was just very subtle and that we never found. But for the most part, you know, when that interrupt would fire, we just reset the UARTs, it'd go back to running, and every once in a great while, when we did that, it wouldn't clean it up, and then you'd have to either manually reset the UART because the flag saying it was messed up was cleared, but it was still messed up. And if you just cycled it again, then that would fix it. So we added some commands into the, both the text adventure and my menus where you could just send a reset to the UARTs and clear it up manually. And if it was someone who didn't want to do that, you just power cycle the badge and it's all fat, dumb, and happy again. Hardware-wise, any other hardware unique things? I think that's pretty much it on here. The only other challenge is the way they did the sides. At one point in time, the thought was we'd let the users pull the bottom off and rotate it and then put it back on to sort of enable different modes. So I came up with a detection method where one side had a reverse bias diode across one of the LEDs. So then they could drive a line high and then do sense on the LED line, and if it's the side with the diode, the line would be pulled high. Versus if it was one of the normal sides without the diode, it would just float low. I got that backwards. You drive the line low, and if it was right, the line coming back into the propeller would be low, and if it was one of the normal sides, there'd be no connection, so then the pull-up resistor on those lines would send it back high. Soon as we assembled these and put them out the battery on them and put them in the cubes, we found out, one, the force needed to pull these out was significant, and the easiest way to pull them out was to grab the IRDA modules, which broke them off. And two, getting the battery in there without snagging the wires or crushing the terminal board on it was really tough. So we sort of abandoned that option on all the badges. It was just going to cause more problems. If we were going to do that again and we actually wanted, that was a required feature, we'd have to put some sort of little handle on the back to help people pull it out without grabbing the sides. So I think that's about it for this guy. Things that caused us headaches was, just solder issues on the regulator, solder issues in general, which I won't go into. IRDAs being broken off, and that's more of a function of the package. The only thing holding these guys on are the little solder joints in the bottom, and the pads would actually rip out of the IRDA module. Now, had we stuck with an IRDA module like this guy, where it has a metal clip over it, I think that wouldn't have been such an issue. But unfortunately, this was the next cheapest one that actually worked well. So that's what we went with. I think that's about it for hardware on this guy. We also built up some of these for the conference. This is basically the same PIC chip with, we threw an RGB LED on there just for status to come out, and then an IRDA and a button. The idea was, and it mostly worked other than one code bug that we didn't find it until the day of the conference, so it was too late to fix. But the other button on the back is a software button. It could either turn the badge off if you held it, or if you pressed it, it would send a social flag to another badge, and then you could take that badge up to this guy, and the scoreboard software at the con would pull all the pending flags out of the badge, process them, and then send back a signal to the badge saying, okay, I got those, delete them. So this was sort of the interface to the badge network for the scoring system. I also used it in the bring up of these badges is just an IRDA debug device. There was many issues we ran into or weren't quite sure where things were going wrong, so we'd set that guy out in front of the badge, do whatever we're doing, and then we could see in real time the packets coming across and go, oh, I transmitted the wrong checksum, or oh, that packet's exactly how I think it should be. Okay, it must be in the receiving code that's having a problem. So, division of labor. Initially, the plan was this guy was only going to convert, it emulates a CDC serial port to the operating system of whatever you plug this into. So initially, the PC would come up, turn the CDC USB packets into a serial stream, feed that to the prop, and also give prop access to the two IRDA modules as two more serial ports. The toy makers quickly ran out of space in the prop. They just had so much stuff they wanted to get in there and needed to get in there to get to their envision of what they wanted this badge to do, that it quickly became apparent that I needed to do more heavy lifting down in this guy. Where it ended up is this guy runs both the USB stack doing serial communication as well as a IRDA and networking stack, so that I support basically 16 ports, let's say, that users can log into. Port 0, the input's hardwired to USB to the USB port. But everyone else, when a new badge or new connection comes in IRDA, it gets linked to the next free port, and then that's all the data from those ports is exposed to the prop chip as a set of registers. There's a transmit and receive for the initiating register, so if someone else initiates the connection to this guy, there's a transmit and receive buffer. And also this guy for that port can initiate can be an initiator, and it uses a transmit and receive pair on the outbound port. So you can come in USB, do stuff here, and then say, hey, I want to get out to someone else. Set up the outbound port to badge, 42, whatever you want to do. He will pick up any data you put in that set of transmit receive registers and forward it out with network address 42. The other thing we had to offload in order to make more space up here is all the strings. So playing the text adventure, there's long strings of just description and flavor text and everything else. So what we did is we took those, dumped them into my flash, since I had more space, and then made an interface where he just writes a value, a 16-bit value into a register. When I see that 16-bit value, I go out into my flash, grab the string that corresponds to that, and either send it out the USB or IRDA as appropriate. So all the big long strings got pulled out of the EEPROM and the prop and put down into this guy. The other things I took care of was the crypto engine, which Trenton came up to and delivered to us. So it was basically, he gave us a function, I just plopped it in my code, and then I securely stored the crypto key and provided him data in crypto key when we had to send a flag out. Other things that need to be done, or were done, I think that was about it. These two little pads here are for a speaker. This no populated resistor here hooks it to the prop. This resistor down here would hook it to the PIC. PIC never made use of it. The prop does make use of it for, I think it was, if you play with the payphone, it makes all the standard, phone freaking noises that are required. And then if you put the badge into Morse code mode, it would beep out the Morse code of the message of the day, along with blinking the lights to the Morse code of the message of the day. Trying to think, is there any other? I think that was pretty much all of it. In my back doors down here, exposed up here in the Rolodex, I kept track of every time a packet came in, I looked at the address and checked if I've ever seen a packet from that device sent. And if I hadn't seen a packet from that device, I'd set a bit in this array, and then count the number of bits in the array to give you, hey, here's how many unique contacts you've made. I don't think we did much with it in the conference. It was there in case someone wanted to see it. But beyond that, it didn't really get used. Maybe in a future one. Oh, the part of the battery protection circuit, there's a voltage divider right here that's fed into the PIC. Once every, 10 milliseconds, I do an A to D conversion on that voltage, and if it was less than 3 volts, I shut the badge down. The batteries we ordered do have a protection circuit built into the top of them. So in theory, this battery should protect itself from overvoltage, undervoltage, overcurrent. But just to be safe, we have the appropriate charge controller built in, plus this undervoltage lockout in the PIC. That way we don't have to rely on the battery. We have two layers of protection to keep anything bad from happening to the batteries. If you have one of these badges, this is a LiPo battery. I mean, there's no 2 cents around it. Go talk to Samsung. They bought high quality batteries and they still had problems with them. So, you know, don't poke it, don't prod it, don't crush it, don't burn it. Flint, don't use it as an incense burner. Be respectful of these things. If you are, you'll probably never have a problem. If you're not respectful, you're just asking to burn something down. You know, and be respectful, I mean, you know, take care of it, don't freeze it, don't put it in an oven. Like I said, poke it, prod it, whatever. You know, when you're charging this guy, you know, be aware of it. Don't plug it in and leave for 3 months. For those out there, you know, eventually those batteries will go bad. I mean, it'll be a very long time. But if your battery has gone bad and you don't want to replace it and you just want to use the badge, solder a jumper between these two caps on this side next to the battery connector. Make sure to unplug the battery. But if you connect, you bridge those two cap connections there, that will route 5 volts from the USB port directly into the regulator, bypassing the charge controller. Once you do that, then you can plug in your USB cable and run this badge without a battery. With the charge controller in the way, the charge controller sees the power draw of the pick and the prop and thinks it's a fault on the battery because you don't have this big battery out here to even out the current draw. Speaking of that, current draw running is about averages about 100 milliamps. Shut down, like I said, is 6 microamps, but these IRDA modules can draw up to like 3/4 of an amp when they're transmitting. So it's the power draw is very, very spiky. So you have these high spikes when IRDA is going on, and then it averages out to about 100 milliamps. I think that's about it for my part of the hardware. You know, it was basically the routing of this card to get all the wiring from the prop to all the various headers around the edge. You know, if you look, there's a, you know, you can see the big stripe down the bottom and then up each side to get all the wiring where it needed to be. Because we initially wanted to be able to pull and rotate it, one set of the headers on each side is actually duplicated. I can't remember if it's this one or this one, but let's say it's this one. This header, this header, this header, this header all have exactly the same signals on it. Where if we'd abandoned that from the get-go, we could have gotten away with probably a little over half the headers on here, and it would have made the wiring routing much, much easier than it actually turned out to be. So yeah, if you look carefully, you can, I wish I could zoom my camera, but I can't. If you look carefully right through here, you can sort of see where the buses run along the edges and across the back to get back to the propeller, where everything between the propeller, prop, and USB is all crammed right into the center section with only a little bit of stuff on the back. This row of headers right here is the prop or the pick programming. So if you take a picket programmer and plug it in there, this is pin 1, the square pin's pin 1, you can program away. This is the UART/programming port to the propeller chip. Don't know much about them, but again, they have a little prop plug. You plug it in there, you can either run your program out of RAM or you can burn it into this EEPROM. Initially, I was going to try and get rid of this EEPROM altogether and put all the data into the PIC. So this guy would wake up, load his program out of the PIC over I2C, and there we go. Again, ran out of time, so that did not get implemented in this version of code. But the connection between these two is the I2C bus that goes to this EEPROM. So I2C comes out of the prop, couple pull-ups, EEPROM, and pick. So I think he's address able 0 on the I2C bus, and I'm address able 2. So all the pick functions are exposed to the prop just as a big I2C address map. Okay, so I think that's enough on that. If I missed anything, shoot me a comment or hit me on Twitter and I'll expand on it, but I think that's all the high points. Now, as for the conference itself, they gave us some nice little swag bags. And in the swag bag, we got the CypherCon 2.0 program. A nice metal water bottle. Do little webcam security cover, a bumper sticker, a pen, a chip clip, I think that's what you call those, and I think that's about it. I noticed some of the folks also got a, I guess you call it a USB condom. You know, it slid on the end of here, and then you could plug it into your laptop, and it broke the data lines, but let the power go through, so you didn't have to worry about a malicious hacker making something that looked like a charge port, but actually was an active data connection. And what else did I get? So that was the swag bag right there. One of the Flint at the Makerspace printed up some of these little 3D printed stands that we gave away. Also, there was pagoda connectors, as we call them, where you could stack cubes on top of each other, and then the little lids to put on the top of it, so it looked like a little pagoda of badges sitting there. For helping out at the conference, I got a challenge coin, which was pretty cool. So there's the back, and there's the front. And then, above and beyond that, met some interesting guys who gave us some interesting stuff. So let me see. Oops. So the Mr. Blinky Bling guys were there, and they gave us some of their challenge coins. Apparently this is going to do something at DEF CON, be part of another puzzle they're putting together. So there's all sorts of little, symbols and letters and numbers that can mean all sorts of different things. And that's the badge from last year for CypherCon. Mini Marshmallow gave me one of his business cards, which is kind of cool. It has all sorts of various little footprints. I really like collecting little PCB rulers and credit cards, or business cards, when they have interesting stuff like that on them. So that was pretty cool. They also gave me one of their little USB blinker things. You basically plug it in, and this thing is pretty blinding. So they were pretty cool to hang out with. Words of advice, if you hang out with the Blinky Bling guys, bring sunglasses. They by far have the most intense badge-like objects ever. It was kind of interesting on the badge panel, whenever one of the Blinky Bling guys was moderating the panel, and anytime he'd walk out into the audience and sort of turn, you could just watch the people cringe as his badge illuminated their faces. So I think that's about all I have for this round. It was pretty fun. So far I have not come down with the con crud, so we'll see if I am able to survive through this week without getting sick. And I think that's all I have. So if anyone has questions, comments, whatever, leave them below or hit me up on Twitter. Later, all.